Good evening, everybody. And welcome to Behind the Curtain, presented to you by the Phoenix Theater Company. My name is Michael Barnard, and I'm the producing artistic director of the theater, and we are thrilled to be with you here tonight. Now, you might ask, well, what is Behind the Curtain? What Behind the Curtain is we're going to take a look at what goes on at the theater before we open the curtain and present to you the magic of live theater. So the subjects will vary from week to week. This will be a weekly presentation, and the subjects will vary. It could be anything from how does an actor memorize a part? How does a composer begin the journey of starting to write a new song that has never been written before? How does a stage manager call the cues, call the light cues, call the scene shift cues, call the costume cues? How does a quick change work? When an actor goes off wearing one costume and comes back in 5 seconds later wearing something else? So the subjects will vary from week to week, and we will have different artists joining me each week to sort of present everything from a scenic design to a dance, a dance and creating a dance. So we're very, very excited to be here with you because as you can see all around me, there's a plethora of wonderful and exciting artists. Give them a wave, everybody. Oh my God. Some of your favorites are with us tonight. And each week, there'll be a variety of new artists that will be joining us. We wanted to welcome all of you because you, the patron, are the essential thing that we exist for. As an artist, we were born to console, to comfort, to teach, to educate, to unify, and to entertain. And before you, you've got a great group of individuals that love to entertain. You are our bright light, and that's the most important thing that we can say to you. We are living to be with you again and to bring you the magic of live theater. I thought that this first Behind the Curtain adventure would come your way by looking at what is coming next to you from a programmatical standpoint. What shows are coming up for you in the near future? And to help me are all of these beautiful, beautiful, talented artists. They have a wealth of extraordinary abilities. And so I'm pleased and pleasured to have them with me tonight. So what I'm gonna do is I'm going to invite each one of our guests to introduce themselves, tell you how they got started at the Phoenix Theater Company, and maybe a funny anecdote about that. And then also tell you what their favorite role was at the Phoenix Theater Company as we go down a little bit of memory lane. So I'm gonna start with the incomparable associate artistic director. His name is Robert Colby Harper, and he's also the director of our Newark development. And so Robbie, how did you get started? What show did you start with at the Phoenix Theater Company? And what's your favorite role, et cetera? So you're on, buddy.
Well, I think first, thank you, Michael. Thank you so much. I think I need to pump up the romance. This is my first show at Phoenix Theater Company. It was back in 1992. And it was Hello, Dolly, where I played Barnaby against Rusty Farrakhan's Cornelius.
Oh, wow.
It was a magical, magical moment that we have replayed many, many times. And my favorite show that I have done is not that. No.
Love it.
Is Six Dance Lessons in 6 Weeks. And that was my favorite show. And so I'm going to pass it on to the amazing associate producing director and director of Partners at Heel, Mr. Pasha Yamatahari.
Thank you, Robert Colby Harper, and good evening, dear patrons. We miss you all. We miss you very, very much. Ironically, my first show, when I was allowed to leave my intern desk gathering with dusk, because I was the intern to Michael Barnard at the time as the assistant to Michael. And I was given leeway to leave for a little bit for a quick audition for Robert Colby Harper for the role of Robert in the comedy Boing Boing. And that was my first show. I have so many favorite shows as a director and actor, but truly as an immigrant to numerous countries, to be able to audition and get the part of the role of Usnavi with so many of my friends here on the screen, to be able to tell that story and something that was so close to my heart was very, very, very important and a great, great, great experience with such wonderful artists, but also you, the patrons. That being said, directing once the musical, Hedwig, Lady Day, just amazing experiences for me. But there's always a guy that's always taller than me. He's always so much taller than me on stage, whether it's 39 Steps or Baskerville, just towering above me. So from Toby House on Toby Lane in Toby County, here's Toby Yotso.
Thank you, Pasha. Very kind of you. From my second favorite Canadian ever. I am Toby Yotso. I am artist in residence at Phoenix Theatre Company proudly for over a decade now. And my first show with Phoenix Theatre Company was in 2007, Guys and Dolls. And I am so lucky, and I'll quickly tell you why, because that season I actually chickened out for the general auditions, and I thought I wasn't ready, so I canceled my audition at the last minute. Then I went to see Thoroughly Modern Millie that opened that season, and I flogged myself all the way home because I was just amazed by what I had seen, and I knew that this was the company I wanted to work for. And so, lucky me, there was extra ad hoc auditions added midway through the season because Michael and Robbie were looking for additional ensemble members for the male ensemble in Guys and Dolls. So I went to this audition, and because it was scheduled separately from the generals, I was kind of all by myself. We were in little single appointments, and I ended up singing and doing a monologue for Michael Barnard, and it was his first time meeting me. And as the story goes, I believe he was exceptionally blown away by my height. And so he passed the message off to Robbie saying, well, he's fun, but he's exceptionally tall. So dance him hard and make sure that he doesn't fall over. So I was lucky enough to have a one-on-one dance audition with Robbie, just me and him in the room, and he danced me, and we did all kinds of tricks, and I had a blast, and it was a very special moment, and I did not fall over, and I booked it. And 13, 14 years ago, and it's just been such a great chapter of my life, being able to share live theater with all of you out there. And I can't wait to see you all again in person because the Phoenix Theater Company stage is my favorite place to be. And I think some of my favorite experiences would be, ranking up there is playing Bert in Mary Poppins 5 years ago with several folks on this screen, including Trisha, my Mary. And I got to tap dance on the ceiling, y'all. That was unforgettable. And I also was very honored to be in the one-man play Buyer and Seller. And doing a one-man play was absolutely life-changing. Yes. So I have the pleasure of hitting it off here to one of my favorite fabulous funny ladies on stage, Johanna.
Hi. My name is Johanna Carlisle Cepeda. Can you all see us and hear me? I hope so. So unbeknownst to the patrons, I actually started my career with the Phoenix Theatre Company, I believe it was 1992, backstage as a wardrobe person with the Cookie Company, for a play called Young Maria's Tall Chief. But on stage, my very first time appearing was in 2009 in Curtin with so many people on in this forum here tonight. And it was amazing to finally be on stage at the Phoenix Theater Company. My favorite show for the longest time was doing Toxic Avenger, playing Mayor Ma with, again, quite a few people are in this forum here. But for me, the show that stole my heart was doing Americano this year. It was an amazing opportunity to be able to new work something and create it from the start and work on this for almost 5 years and bring the part of Felicita Pasolino to life and to get to know her in real life. And thank you to Michael for allowing this to happen and for just bringing this beautiful piece. And I'm excited to see it where we go. And on top of that, I got to work with the person that I'm about to pass this off to, who played my husband, Martin.
Hi, everybody. My name is Joseph Cannon. So welcome. We miss you guys very much. We'll be with you again soon. So a couple of things. I moved here in 2011 for the second time. And I thought, you know what? I'm just going to go out and audition for Phoenix Theater the next season. So I did. And I was called back for the role of Lancelot in Spamalot. And I went and I read for it, and I didn't hear anything for weeks. And then I was like, I get it, and I'm just doing the actor thing. And I was like, I'm the worst actor on the planet. And then I got a phone call from Tasha, and he said, would you like me to come and read for King Arthur? And I thought, King Arthur? Okay, yeah, I'll read for King Arthur. And I read, and I said, well, what can I do? What can I do to stand out? So I remember walking up the stairs, and I opened the door, and I said, what is the play? And what is my part? Michael's look on his face. So that was a really great show for me to be a part of. I love playing King Arthur, but just recently, and I'm just going to piggyback off of what Johanna said. Americano, I was lucky enough to play Martin Valdovino and to work with it from the beginning and be this fine actor's husband for a couple of years. And it was a pleasure and a ride and an experience that I will never forget. So thank you. And with that, I'm going to pass it off to Alyssa Giorillo.
Hi, everybody. I'm so, so happy and delighted to be here with you all tonight. My first show at the Phoenix Theater Company was when I was still a student at Arizona State University, and it was through the ASU collaboration that Phoenix Theater has with them that I was able to do Curtains in 2009, where I met so many of these beautiful artists that you see before you and worked with them for the first time. And I learned so much. It was my first professional show. It was my first musical ever doing that. And it was awesome. And obviously I was addicted. I'm going to choose two favorite roles that I've had on the Phoenix Theater Company stage. One was Eva Perón in Evita. It was such a dream and an honor. And I just learned so much, and it meant the world to me for so many reasons, both personal and artistic, to be able to play that role. And the second one I'm going to choose is Yitzhak from Hedwig and the Angry Inch. I just connected to that role in a very unexpected way, and it's a role I never anticipated I would ever be able to play. And so I'm just very grateful for that experience. And now I'm going to pass it off to the beautiful, lovely couple, Matrevious Event and Trisha Ditsworth.
Woo! Hey y'all, I'm Matrevious.
Hi, I'm Trisha.
And my first show at Phoenix Theater Company was Rent. I played Benny in Rent, directed by Robbie Harper, music directed by Craig Baumler. My favorite show, well, I'm really looking forward to playing Nigel in Something Rotten once we get back up. It's gonna be so much fun. Otherwise, a show that will always be special to me is Memphis the Musical, and that was the show that I met Trisha on. So.
Yeah, yeah.
Yay! My first show at Phoenix Theater was a show that not a lot of people know very well. It's called The Spitfire Grill, and I played Percy, and it was really, really a challenge for me, a very different role from most of the ingenues that I had played in the past, and it meant a lot to me to be able to do that. My favorite role at Phoenix Theater is incredibly difficult to choose, but I think I'd have to go with Mary Poppins in Mary Poppins, and also Maria in The Sound of Music, which was just an absolutely mind-blowing experience, and really miss being on that stage and miss seeing all of you patrons out there. All right, I'm gonna pass it along to Craig and Rusty.
Hey, thank you, Tricia. Hello, everybody. I love being with all my colleagues, and I wish I could see all the patrons out there because we miss you incredibly. We're interpretive artists and we can't interpret, so we miss you. So we can't wait to get back on the stage to share our joy and our life with you guys. So anyway, if you ask an actor what his favorite role is, it's really hard because we love every role we're doing. And when you get really old like me and you've done a million roles, it's really hard to pick one. So I've done over 30 shows at Phoenix Theater Company for 28 years. And my first one was in 1992, like Robbie said, with in Hello Dolly. I was Cornelius to his Barnaby. And I know. As far as my favorite role, probably I would have to go with Miguel de Cervantes, Don Quixote in Man of La Mancha. I was honored to play that role. I convinced Michael to let me audition for it, and then he cast me. But that was 20 years ago, so a little more current. Maybe I would have to go with Bruce Bechdel, the father, the tortured father in Fun Home. That was a really challenging role, and I just loved doing it. That's about it. So next is Craig Baumler.
Hey, so my first show at Phoenix Theater, I am not a singer. You don't want to hear me do that. It'll be hurtful. All right. My first show was in 1991 at Phoenix Theater when it was Phoenix Little Theater, and it was Romance, Romance. And then as a composer, I have written four shows that Phoenix Theater has premiered. I've written 12, but Phoenix Theater's premiered four of them. And I believe Michael's directed all of them. And so, but my first one was Gunmetal Blues. And with Phoenix Little Theater in those days, that launched my career, which has been a pretty successful one nationally. So I thank you, particularly Michael and Robbie, for setting up this New Works program, because as you know, New Works are kind of where I live. And I think it's deeply important. Three of my shows went through the New Works program. And so I am deeply honored and pleased to be part of that.
I know our audience, Craig, will, in a future episode, will be excited to hear just how a composer starts to create a song that's never been heard before. So look forward to that in the future.
Thank you. Oh, yes, and I would like to hand that off to Chris Erickson, the indefatigable. Yay. Chris Erickson.
Ooh, nice.
You.
Thank you, Craig. And I don't know if you remember, Craig, but almost 30 years ago, you were my very first music director in the first show I ever did. I know. And it was a fleeting moment because it was 42nd Street, and it extended for an extra week, and they needed to sub somebody in. So I had 3 days to learn all the tap dance numbers and the music and everything and cram it into my head. And so you music directed me for that. And that was just not you frightening, but having 3 days to learn the show. Serious all get out. But my first real show I auditioned for and got was a show called I Hate Hamlet. And I got to perform with hopefully some of the audience that's watching us, some of their favorites, John Sankovich and Bob Sorensen. We just had a blast having fun in that comedy. Now, favorite shows, I mean, most definitely my favorite role, and I was so honored and touched to be able to play Dad in Billy Elliot. It was such a touching role and meant so much to me. And I had the best seat in the house. I know you all watching Billy Elliot had a great time, but in the second act, when Billy was doing his performance of Electricity, I got to sit on stage every night and watch it like 6 feet away from him. So that was just thrilling. But Billy Elliot was just something so special for me, and learning the Geordie accent. Thank you, Pasha.
Do some of it, Chris. Do some of the Geordie accent.
Let's see. Billy, get downstairs now. Your breakfast is ready.
There it is.
It's been 3 years. So that was definitely a highlight for me. And then I'm going to tack on most recently being able to play Scott Richter in Americano in the world premiere recently. It's been such an experience and a ride from 5 years ago, almost seeing it develop and be rewritten and transformed and finally do the world premiere. And let's just see where this one goes, because it's such an important message and such a touching show. And it's so much fun for us performing it and seeing all of you watching us, and we get to watch you. So we miss being able to do that. Like Rusty was saying, we miss being in front of all of you so much. So hang in there, we'll be live and in front of you soon. And now I get to pass things on to one of my closest friends. I was in his first show, but I won't spoil that for you. Lucas Cody! Lucas!
Hi, everyone. I'm Lucas Cody. Just want to thank you all. I had a wave of emotion right before I spoke. A few tears. We miss you. We miss you. And I can't say that enough. We can't say that enough. My first show at Phoenix Theater, or the Phoenix Theater Company, was A Chorus Line in 2001, and I was the Larry to Chris Erickson's Zach, and also with Robbie Harper on that one. A few of my favorite roles, one would be Americano. And just the interaction and that we had with the audience and the impact that we felt from all of you on the piece that we had worked at, that all of these people had worked on, was so incredible. And I think that's why, because of you, it was such a great experience for us. And another role would probably be Nostradamus in the upcoming production of Something Rotten. I cannot wait. Directed by Kathy Fitzgerald. It's insane and fun. And I can't wait for you to see that. Favorite role. And now on to Chanel Bragg.
Hi, everyone. It's so wonderful to be here and have you see us and see our homes. So we're excited to bring ourselves to you in this format at this time of great uncertainty. But knowing that theater is coming back in full force at the end of the spring, and we're really excited. But for now, we'll give you a little bit of a taste. So my first show was Hairspray, directed by Michael Barnard. I met a lot of my greatest friends in that show that I'm still with friends over 10 years now from that show. My very favorite role is tied between Meta Larkin and Newsies. And I absolutely love playing Carla in The Heights, and that was directed by Robbie Harper. And both of them musically directed by the Alan Ruck, which was a beautiful experience. And so it's just been kind of fantastic to have worked here for 10 years. I consider Phoenix Theater my home, and I am so, so grateful to be a part of this wonderful group of colleagues that we have here. So coming up is a power duo, a power team that I've literally have known the oldest, I think, in the theater community. I've been friends with them since I first started back in like 2009. So give it up for Mark and Lindsay Foreman.
Hello, everyone. Thank you so much. Thanks for being here tonight. I'm Mark Foreman. The first show that I worked on at the Phoenix Theater Company, now I'm a musician, so it wasn't actually, I mean, I guess we were on the stage for that one. It was Hairspray. And I also was... played keys three in that. And for those of you that don't understand what keys three, one or two means, one is usually mainly piano driving everything, but keys three is the fun rhythm section book. So I got to play a lot of the strings and the organ. And then in that show also, I had the privilege and opportunity to conduct the role for 2 weeks. Alan Ruck had to step aside and go work on something else. And so I was privileged privileges, dizzed is the new word, have that opportunity to work with a lot of these people here on the screen and get to conduct that show for 2 weeks. So that was that. And then in addition to that, probably one of my favorite acting roles there was I got to step in and do Skizup in Hedwig for the extension over there.
Hi, everybody. I'm Lindsay Foreman. It's so awesome to be here. We miss you guys so much. I miss the stage. I miss the audience. I miss the lights. I miss all of it. My first show was also Hairspray, and I was scared out of my mind. It was my first professional show ever. And when I found out, I almost peed. And I told two people right away. I told Mark Foreman. And I actually, the second person I ever told was Toby. He doesn't even know this. Because we were doing Evil Dead together. And he was also in Hairspray. And I was scared out of my mind. So I was like, Toby, what am I going to do? And it was pretty much the best moment of my life. It changed my life. It gave me a place to call home and theater, and I love it so much. Favorite roles are two roles of mine. Daniela in In the Heights was one of my favorites. Fun fact, I actually, my first day of rehearsal was the fifth week after I had my baby, Shiloh Hope, who's running around here somewhere. So that was a challenge. doing rehearsals with a five-week-old baby at home. And then my second favorite role, and probably the most challenging one I've ever done, is playing Lorraine in Jersey Boys, because it's more of an ingenue character. And if you check out my resume, you'll find that I am a character actress by trade. So it was it was quite fun to be able to play the ingenue for once.
And Lindsay, I so remember you coming in to audition for us. For that show, and you were like 6 or 7 months pregnant, and it was just hysterical to see you. Actually, you were dancing, for heaven's sake.
Yes, I did the dance call, and I was 7.5 months pregnant.
I know. Yes. It was just amazing.
And there's video of it.
Yes, there is. So
I expect Shiloh to be performing on our stage, dancing her little heart out.
Oh, she will be. You're lucky.
So, now, ladies and gentlemen, what we would love to do, or what I would love to do, is get some of these wonderfully talented individuals to tell you a little bit about the shows that are going to be coming your way and get you excited about the magic of live theater. Oh my gosh, I know that every one of us has said this, but we cannot wait to see all of you again. The first show that is definitely going to be coming your way is going to be perfect coming out of this hideous period that we are in right now, because the show is called Something Rotten, and it is nothing but fun. It is one laugh after another. It takes place during the Renaissance period, and it is one funny musical romp. Four individuals who are on your video screen right now are in the show. Toby Yatso plays the arrogant and sexy William Shakespeare. And Lucas Coatney plays the dizzy and crazy and hysterically funny Nostradamus, the soothsayer. But this magical couple that is before you, Matravius and Trish, are also in it, and I'm going to let them tell you what role they play, and then we're going to turn it over and have you hear a little excerpt of one of the big production numbers from the musical Something Rotten. Trey?
Thanks, Michael. I play Nigel in Something Rotten.
And I play the character of Bee.
She's my sister-in-law. It's not awkward at all in the rehearsal. So Something Rotten is a big, hilarious musical spectacular about two brothers, Nick and Nigel Bottom, and they're attempting to write the next big thing in theater.
It's set in the Renaissance era, and the character of William Shakespeare is played by Toby Yatso, as Michael said, and the two brothers are trying to write something better than Shakespeare.
And a really funny moment in the show is when Nick, the older brother, is so desperate to write a hit that he pays a soothsayer to tell him what that idea is.
Now that's played by Lucas Coatney. The character is Nostradamus, and it is one of my absolute favorite songs in the show. It's ridiculous and fun. Take it away, Lucas.
Go see our musical, a musical. There's nothing as amazing as a musical. Song contents, sweet romance, and happy endings happening by happenstance. Stage fights and a dazzling chorus. If you want to be great, then you gotta create a musical. Let's just say it's a Saturday night and you want to go out on the town. Got a lady to flatter who might give up if you don't let her down. You could go see a tragedy, that wouldn't be very fun. Or a play from Greek mythology, see a mother have sex with their son. Ooh. You could go see a drama with all that drama and play. Or go see something more relaxing and less taxing on the brain. Go see a musical, a puffy piece releasing all your musicals, where crooners are catchy tune and limber leggy ladies will you tell your swoon. Those are good ones. And a standing ovation. If you want to be great, then you got to create a musical.
Good job, Lucas. Thank you so much. Ladies and gentlemen, there are more than 419 costumes in Something Rotten. And each one is funnier and bigger than the one before. And during this song, this huge production number called A Musical that Lucas takes the lead in, you get to see practically half of these costumes, I swear, as we take on an outrageous look of every musical that you can imagine. So it is just sheer fun, and it's gonna put a smile on your face from ear to ear. So thank you, all of you, for participating and being a part of Something Rotten. And now, what's going to also open at the same exact time in the Hormel Theater is the classic science fiction pop rock musical, The Rocky Horror Picture Show, or The Rocky Horror Show. I guess the film is The Rocky Horror Picture Show, and the musical is The Rocky Horror Show. Our dramaturg, Pasha Yamahari, is shaking his head and letting me know exactly my error in my ways, but I'm just, at any rate, Mr. Robert Harper is going to be directing the Rocky Horror Show. And Mark Forman is going to be our musical director for the show. And Lindsay Forman, his beautiful wife, is going to be playing the role of Magenta in the Rocky Horror Show. And she's going to sing a song from this. And ladies and gentlemen, I will interject here also as well that we'll be doing a Q&A after our little presentation here. So if you wanna get on chat, there's a chat button down there if you've ever used it before, and you can just type in a question that you would like to ask one of us on the screen, and we'll do a short Q&A after our presentation. Also, there is a donation button down at the bottom if you so choose and are moved to hit that button. But for right now, let's go to Lindsay Forman and Mark Forman and hear a little bit from The Rocky Horror Show.
Over a barrel when tarantula took to the hills. And I really got hot when I saw Jeanette Scott line a trip in Desmond's poison and cave. Dana Andrews said rooms, gave him the room, and passing them your clothes of skin.
Mark and Lindsay. It was so much fun to hear that. And just be reminded of the quirky, fun music and the wild story behind the Rocky Horror Show. So we're all anticipating anxiously to see that piece come to life. Now, I'd like to introduce you to somebody that you've never seen on stage before. But it's because you probably can't look up high enough to be able to see his face. However, he has appeared many, many times. The young and strapping Mr. Toby Yatso. And we are going to be bringing him to the stage as Claude in the retrospective Youth Revolution classic musical that sort of changed the entire way and the entire evolution of musical theater in the late 60s. The musical, of course, was Hair. And here to sort of sing that title role is Mr. Toby Yatso, playing the role of Claude.
She asks me why I'm just a hairy guy. I'm hairy noon and night, hair that's a fright. I'm hairy high and low. Don't ask me why, don't know. It's not for lack of bread, like the Grateful Dead. Darling, give me a head with hair, long, beautiful hair, shining, gleaming, screaming, flaxing, waxing. Give me down to there, hair shoulder length or longer. Here, daddy, there, mama, everywhere, daddy, daddy, hair. Flow it, show it, long as God can grow it, my hair. Let it fly in the breeze and get caught in the trees. Give a home to the fleas in my hair. A home for fleas, a hive for bees, a nest for birds. There ain't no words for the beauty, the splendor, the wonder of my hair. Flow it, show it, long as God can grow it, my hair.
Boy, does that bring me back, and I'm sure that brings many of you out there watching tonight, back to an era and a time, sex, drugs, rock and roll, the late 60s. If you can believe this, when I was a young teen, my hair was down past my shoulders, and I was certainly screaming the song Hair at that time. But that was in a galaxy far, far away. So coming up for you after this is a musical bio, a bio musical, biographical musical, in the same vein like Jersey Boys, except that this beautifully written piece surrounds the exciting and incredibly talented Gloria Estefan and the Miami Sound Machine. And the song, the musical is called On Your Feet. And here to sing a little bit of On Your Feet is the incredibly talented Alyssa Chiarello. Woo!
All right, we're gonna do a little 1, 2, 3. And we're gonna see how this goes.
1, 2, 3, 4. Come on, baby, say it on me 5, 6, 7 times. So no matter what it takes, I will steal your heart away. Take a chance for what you won't regret it. Take my love, just come and get it. 1, 2, 3, 4. Come on, baby, say it on me 5, 6, 7. Seven times, eight, counting. I'm just gonna keep on counting until you are my eye.
I am telling you, ladies and gentlemen, you are ready. You are in for a treat. If you loved Gloria Estefan and the Miami Sound Machine, well, this musical will, by every indication, will have you dancing in the aisles. And it is an incredible story. She is a true heroic character, and a very strong and formidable woman's very exciting story. Unusually exciting. I think it's a really well-crafted biographical musical on Gloria Estefan and the Miami Sound Machine. So we really look forward to bringing that to you. Also, around the same time will be the very poignant and incredibly powerful musical that was named after the book and the film, and now the musical, The Color Purple. And I can't think of a better entertainer to sing a portion of a song to just entice you with this musical than the effervescent and extraordinarily talented Chanel Bragg.
I believe I have inside of me everything that I need to live a bountiful life with all the love alive in me. I'll stand as tall as the tallest tree, and I'm thankful for every day that you've given, both the easy and the hard ones I'm living, but most of all I'm thankful for loving who I really am. I'm beautiful, yes, I'm beautiful, and I'm here.
Yay!
Amazing, Chanel, amazing. And now, since we are doing just the first half or to the calendar end year of our shows coming to you, and then next week we're gonna do the second half of our season. The final show at the calendar year is during the holidays. It is the immortal classic from Rodgers and Hammerstein, Cinderella, and it's the new adaptation of it that was on Broadway for several years recently. I'm here to tell you a little bit about this adaptation, and to sing you a little excerpt from one of the songs of Cinderella is the beautiful and extraordinarily talented, beautiful soprano, Trisha Ditsworth.
Hello again. Cinderella is such a wonderful, wonderful, beautiful show. It's going to be perfect for the holiday season. All the music, all those iconic songs that everybody knows, and of course, a little bit of magic, which is just what we need for the holidays and what we need all the time, actually. This song is actually one of my favorites to sing, and I've been singing it since I was a little girl.
Aww.
A lovely night, a lovely night, a finer night you know you'll never see. You meet your prince, a charming prince, as charming as a prince will ever be. The stars in the hazy heavens tremble above you while he's whispering, darling, I love you. You say goodbye, away you fly, but
on your lips you leave a kiss. All your life you'll wait for this lovely, lovely night.
Oh, oh gosh, that is one of just so many beautiful songs that Rodgers and Hammerstein wrote for this enchanting, enchanting holiday musical. So thank you, Trish, for bringing that. Now, what we're going to do is open it up for some questions that have been coming in from our audience and turn them out to several people to answer these questions. So I'm going to turn the first question over to Pasha Yamatahari, and he's going to choose some of our celebrity folk here tonight to answer those answer the first question. Pasha?
Well, that would be my pleasure, Michael. It looks like our first question is from Rachel in Y, Arizona. And the question is, and it's actually a fun one for me as director of casting for the Phoenix Theater Company, I'm going to ask this to Johanna, to be honest. Johanna, what is the first thing you do when you learn you have been cast?
the first thing that happens when I get cast, and I cry a lot, and then I usually call you, Pasha, and cry on your voicemail and thank you profusely for giving me the opportunity to do a show on the stage, because I'm always humbled to be able to perform with the artist that I perform with, and I cry a lot. That's what I do.
Well, Johanna, you know, all artists earn the part and they fight hard for it. I'm just the guy that gets to tell them the happy news. Michael, do you want to go to the second question?
Yeah, of course. I'm so sorry. Actually, the second question is going to be presented by Mr. Robert Colby Harper.
Great.
Okay. Let's see. What's going on here? All right. Oh, look, there it is. This is from Tammy in Anthem. Hi, Tammy.
Hi, Tammy.
How you doing?
Hi, Tammy.
So good to see you, Tams. Let's see. What? I can't read. God, getting old sucks, y'all. what role would you most like to play that you haven't played yet? Oh, okay. I am going to throw that one to Joseph and Rusty.
Joseph, take it away.
Yes. Hi, I'm Joseph Kinn. My favorite role that I would love to play at some point in my career is Sweeney Todd. It's been my dream since I can remember. So since I heard Lynn Carew play it. Rusty?
Excellent choice. And Rusty?
Well, I've been fortunate to play a lot of dream roles of mine already. But thinking really outside the box, maybe Mama Rose and Gypsy.
A fine mother you are.
All the Sarah Kane should be Mama Rose.
Well, you almost did play Mama Rose in Ruthless.
That's true.
Ruthless was the very first show that opened the Hormel Theater, right. And Rusty played an exquisite woman, a very kind and gentle femme fatale.
I was a pretty girl.
Yes. Ruthless was very much about a lot of ruthless people. And Rusty was one of them in drag. So and that's what I'm referring to. Our next question actually is, why are you an artist, or why are you an actor? And I'm going to throw this out actually to Robbie, Pasha, and Mr. Craig Baumler. So Robbie, do you want to try to answer that? Why are you an artist?
Such a big question. I think because when you're an artist, you have the opportunity to work with a great amount of people in a collaborative nature, which I really, really love. You get to create different realities and you get to make people laugh and feel and see stories about people who they may not identify with and still really plug into the humanity of how we're all very similar. So that's my favorite thing.
Very cool, very cool. Craig?
Well, I started writing music when I was 16. It just seemed the creator endowed me with the gift to be able to do that. And I was taken to the stage, to see the stage early on by my parents, took me to see Camelot. And with, I got to see Julie Andrews and Richard Harris do Camelot. And I got to see Debbie Reynolds do Unsinkable Molly Brown on stage. These were all at the Casa Manana in Fort Worth, which you got to go to, and it was a pretty big theater. And so my parents took me there and I got to see that. And then I saw my first opera, Aida, at 13. And that was pretty awesome. And so I went, I think I have to write for the stage. And so, and what I've learned is that from other composer friends of mine who do not write for the stage, the wonderful thing about writing for the stage is that, like Robbie said, it's the collaborative thing you get to do with other people. Because if you're just writing a piece for yourself in your room alone and a symphony orchestra plays it, you're always going to be alone. But when you get to hang out with actors and designers and directors and lyricists and book writers, then, you know, I don't know. I was compelled. It's like, I guess it's like a drug. Once I was infected, I was hooked.
And Pasha?
That's a great question. As everybody else was talking, as Robbie and Craig were talking, I was just thinking about, it's ironic that right now I'm in my living room / dining room, because as a kid, this was where I created stories, whether with my toys or just in my own imagination. And I think that propelled me to one day wanting to be a storyteller. And I think the reason I do what I do, whether as a director or an actor or help put a cast together, is putting the right storytellers together to tell the right story. And the most important thing to me is there's a story happening with you, the audience, the story of who you are on your way to the theater, who you are when you get there, and who you are after you leave, after a story you just got to experience. And so with that, it was just a little emotional hearing that question and just knowing that we miss you because you're part of the reason why I do what I do.
Thank you, Pasha. Thank you, Robbie. Thank you, Craig, for those very eloquent answers. We just got a question that came in, a new one. I'm going to throw this one to Chanel. Chanel, what is your go-to song for an audition?
My go-to song, because my dream role is to play Aida from Aida. And I always love to sing Easy as Life. But it's really hard for the accompanist normally to play it though, because it's a very difficult time signature. So I'm not doing a very good job, but I chose that song because it's very difficult. But if you have a great pianist, then you nail it. So Easy as Life from Aida.
Great, great. So Alyssa, I'm gonna throw you a question that just came in. So how do you manage a day job and then doing a show and rehearsing a show and doing a show at night? And Lucas, I'd love to hear from you because I know you're a Lululemon guy and you, anyway, love to hear your answer. So Alyssa?
Well, I've been fortunate enough that usually when I'm doing a show, I don't have to balance a day job. But on the in between, like for example, I really wanted to go to Disneyland over this last winter break. And so then I had to pick up a job during Kinky Boots. And then I was working at Candytopia. And I just try and find a job that's fun, but it's not like too taxing, but still in the realm of what I do. That way, like, because as long as I'm keeping positive all throughout the day, then I don't feel like I've really done too much work. Because even just doing shows, even though that's technically work, it's the most fun and it's the most blessed thing that's what I get to do for a living. So I just try and find something that's fun, something that I enjoy doing that I'm not gonna hate like waking up in the morning to go do.
Lucas, how do you manage work and shows?
It's actually pretty hard because it's almost like two full-time jobs. And what I do when I get cast in a Phoenix Theater Company show is I let the company I work for is Lululemon, and I let them know, and then I let the theater know, and it's just like, kind of like a balance of scheduling that you have to figure out, but you also have to figure out a work-life balance. Something that's very important, that you're taking time for yourself, because it can be really taxing doing like two full-time jobs, an actor and working in retail. So basically I just kind of compare my notes schedule-wise with both the theater and Lululemon, and hopefully it works out. Sometimes it doesn't, but luckily I work for two great companies that help me. So, yeah.
And Chris, you often do shows for us, but you are a full-time teacher. How do you manage it?
Actually, I didn't know this question was coming, but I have something that will... That's how I do it. This thing is my head. I drink a lot of coffee. I get up early in the morning at about 5:30 in the morning and grade papers and prep for school. And I teach all day till 3:30. And then I hop in the car and race to the theater and start rehearsals at 4 and rehearse all the way till 11 o'clock at night. You folks might not realize we rehearse till 11 o'clock every night. And then maybe get to bed at about midnight and then get up at 5:30 in the morning and start my coffee run. And so drink a lot of coffee, but I get really, really tired. And so it, like Lucas was saying, it's two full 40 plus hour jobs a week. Yeah. And so it's tiring. It's exhausting, especially when you're done rehearsing and you're doing 8 shows a week. But it's doing two things that I absolutely love. I love teaching fifth grade English at Phoenix Country Day School. And I love working with all of you. I mean, I've had so much pleasure working with literally everyone on the screen here. And it's just a joy. So when you love doing both of them, you find the time and then you catch up on the sleep after the run of the show.
Well, I will say to everybody out there, Chris obviously is a very beloved teacher because his students, even the students that he is working with right now, but students that have graduated and gone on and have come back 10 years later, come back to see him. So he's a very beloved teacher and loves the arts. And so he inspires his kids to come and to see us in particular. We're very grateful for that.
Thanks,
Mike. A question came in that's asked, how long do we normally rehearse a show? We rehearse a show for 3.5 weeks. That is from beginning. The first day is usually, if it's a musical, where we start to learn the music, or the cast starts to learn the music from the show itself. And that 3.5 weeks all goes all the way through the two previews that we do before opening night. So it goes in about 2 weeks time, we have rehearsed and put up the entire show. And then we do what we call a designer run, which all the designers come to, the scenic designer, the costume designer, the sound designer, the properties designer, lighting designer. And they come to see what the director and the cast and the choreographer and the musical director have created. And then how does their design impact what they will, what the audience will ultimately see. Shortly after that, we go on stage and we space out the show. Then we do what we call in a musical, we do what we call a sets probe, where the orchestra and the cast meet for the very first time and they sing through the score. And then we begin technical rehearsals where every light cue, costume change, hair change, prop, scenic shift happen over a 3-day period that we call 10 out of 12s, where we actually rehearse 10 hours out of a 12-hour period, 5 hours from 11 to 4, and then we take a 2-hour break, come back at 6 and rehearse from 6 to 11. It's crazy wacky, but that's what we do. And the end of the third day, we do our first dress rehearsal, come back on Tuesday, because Monday's the day off, do another dress rehearsal. We can rehearse during the day. We rehearse during the day on Wednesday, preview that night, rehearse on Thursday, preview that night. We can rehearse on Friday. Oftentimes we try not to, but then we open that night. So that's the complete 3.5 week cycle. Pasha, the question is, also the second part of the question is, how far out do we try to cast a show? Can you answer that question for us?
I could give it a shot. Yeah, depending on the show, but we try to be, it's a very highly competitive world out there and lots of amazing artists here in the Valley and lots of amazing theater companies. There's a lot of planning that goes into getting generals on time and callbacks after that and putting the right casts together. I mean, we try to give offers of employment to artists at least 4 to 5, if not 6 months out, so that they know that there's something that's at the end of that time for them financially. And at this time, definitely moving forward as we get ready for the season to come and next season, this is important times for us as a theater company, and we're busy getting ready to do our generals pretty soon.
Great, thank you, Pasha. And Pasha, I'm gonna turn this over to you for the last question. Ladies and gentlemen, this will be our last question of the Q&A. What's wrong, Pasha?
I see the question.
Oh.
Go for it.
Well, Michael, can you read the question?
What is the most difficult thing for you to conquer during the process of a musical? Is the most difficult thing for you to conquer during the process of a musical?
I was reading the question, Toby and Pasha, you have incredible chemistry on stage.
Oh, that's coming up in a minute.
This is the last one.
You said it's the last one.
But you know, there are times that I make an error. And there are times that you, as my associate producing director, want to cover for me. But on this magical night, you've decided not to do that and put me on the bus. However,
I'll take the fall.
Thank you.
Yes, from the previous list of questions from Michael in Y, Arizona, what is the most difficult thing for you to conquer during the process of a musical? Chris, Trey, and Mark, do you guys want to take those?
Sure. I know in talking to a lot of audience members, they always ask me, how do you memorize all those lines? Is that the hardest part? And to be honest, a lot of actors have different methods of memorizing. I always try to memorize everything before we start rehearsal, but I find the hardest part is to keep all the lines that I've memorized beforehand in my head, because during the rehearsal process, it's easy to sit there and repeat lines, but then when the director, like, you know, Michael or Pasha or Robbie, give blocking, which is where we move on stage, as soon as you start moving around, the lines start slipping out of your head, and then you get used to that and you keep them there. And then they start having you use props and you pick something up and you're so busy concentrating on that pot that you picked up that you can't remember your line. And then you get used to that. And then they add costumes and the jacket feels a little weird, and you're so focused on the feel of the jacket that you don't even remember what your name is. So each layer that gets added, and then lights, you get blinded by the lights and then you forget your lines again. So each layer just makes it harder and harder until you just incorporate it all and it becomes like a muscle memory type thing. So in a way, memorizing the lines is hard, but keeping them in your head until you open up is always a challenge.
Thank you, Chris. So no lines, no props, no costumes, no lighting. Yeah, just that makes sense. Trey?
Just stand there and look pretty.
Trey, what about you?
Well, for me, I'm a pretty reserved, kind of quiet person. Well, outside of the home. In my house, I'm a complete nut. I'm bouncing off walls, sliding all over the floor. But outside of here, I'm just very quiet and very much an introvert. But the characters that I love playing are the complete opposite of that. So the challenge for me is to be able to come out my shell enough to really give those characters justice, because I want to do a good job and I love playing those characters so much, but it's a little bit of a challenge because I'm not that way in real life.
Trey, we love seeing you come out of your shell with all the wonderful characters you've portrayed throughout the years. Mr. Foreman, Mr. Mark Foreman.
Yeah, well, as a music director and then going on as conductor for the show, it's a crazy process. It's teaching the vocals, teaching the band what's happening, putting it all together, and then more importantly, figuring out and maintaining the pace of the show. As far as tempos go, coming out of a vamp, for those of you that aren't hip to the vamp term, that's where we just sit there and we play the same kind of figure over and over and over while the actors on stage do their monologue or run around the stage and plug the key into the wall. And we need to make sure that when they turn that key, we're going on with the music. And that honestly is the most stressful part of the process for me in that chair, is staring at that keyhole. And once it's turned, we go, because if we don't, then we sit there and we wait and the audience is like, I think something's supposed to happen. And then it's so yes, that is the process for me, is maintaining the pace and making sure that every night, if the show is supposed to be 2.5 hours, that I'm doing my darndest to make sure that all of our songs are the exact same tempos that they need to be to reach that tempo. Especially when you get into dance breaks, those tap dancers on stage, they can't move their feet as fast as sometimes I would like to take the song. And
I have to tap dancers,
I have to be reminded to slow down. Their feet can only move so fast. So it's the pace of the show for me.
Well, thank you. We have won the last, it was a surprise question, but it's not as big a surprise as it was. This goes to Pasha and Toby. And our patron out there says, the two of you look like you are having so much fun together when you perform together, in particular, I think, probably things like 39 steps, etc. And they just said, are you having as much fun as it appears? Toby?
I am. Yes, absolutely, 100%. Should we tell them, Pasha? So many years ago, oh my God, it was 10 years ago. 10 years ago, Pasha and I were roommates for a year and actually lived together at my house. And I think that's when all our hopes and dreams started. And absolutely, some of the most fun times on stage and memories that I have of being on stage and actually rehearsing shows to come up with all the zaniness that we do get to do is with that very talented man, Pasha Yamatahari.
Oh, that's great.
And right to you, Mr. Yatso. We have songs that we sing one another. We have our own routines pre-show. I think every single artist you guys are seeing out there tonight, it is about collaboration. And I think Toby is probably one of my greatest collaborators. We get each other and we trust each other. All the shows we've done together is physical, or it's a trust physically or emotionally. We look back at the New Works piece that we did. So we are having that much fun, but we can't do it without you guys out in the audience. But we still do sometimes in this kitchen. We used to have fun there too.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, we have so enjoyed spending a little time with you tonight, because you are our bright light. And the knowledge of us coming back to perform for you again and to bring the magic of live theater to you again is what is keeping our heartbeats going. You can imagine that at these times, this 100-year-old institution is having its own difficulties financially, because as a nonprofit arts organization, we depend upon the revenue that comes in from the shows and et cetera. But we also know that everybody is going through hard times. However, if the spirit moves you to donate to the Phoenix Theater Company, we would be humble and grateful. Any donation, large or small, would help mitigate the financial situation of this institution. And from the bottom of our hearts, we appreciate you so much. This is what we do, this, and you are why we do it. So if you do so choose to do a donation, there is a button at the bottom of your screen, and you can just click it, and you can send out a donation into the Phoenix Theater Company. Next week, we will bring you the second half of our season. And then every week subsequently after that, we'll be bringing you secrets from behind the curtain about things that we do to create the magic of live theater for you. And so at this time, we wish you a grateful good night. We look forward to seeing you next week, and you'll hear from us through email and et cetera. But ladies and gentlemen, please give a big, huge round of applause from your home and from our home, our homes, to your homes. We wish you a safe and healthy good night. Everybody say good night. Good night, everybody.
Good night.
Thank you.